My name is Martin Wolf. I have the privilege of serving as the minister of this congregation. On behalf of this congregation and myself, we welcome each and every one of you. I would in particular like to welcome or acknowledge several people who had just a significant role in making today happen. And so Lawrence Muir and Kitty Wrigley are members of this congregation, and about 6 or 9 months ago, they suggested to me that Jack Spong would be just a brilliant speaker, and that is why he is here today. I would also like to express my appreciation for Mary Kelderman, who was one of our co-sponsors. Now, all of you have a short biographical outline here of John Spong. He does prefer to be called Jack. He favors Paul Tillich, I found out last night. He wears a size 44 jacket. And he prefers apple fritters to bread pudding. But you did not come to hear me speak. You came to hear Jack Spong. So without further ado, Reverend John Spong.
When I was a child, they referred to me as old jackass. I'm delighted to be here, and I thank you for being here. I don't think I've been to Springfield before in my life, and I've missed a great deal. I also love being in a Unitarian church. It's the only part of organized Western religion that allows true debate to go on in its midst. Everybody else is trying to propagandize you. Unitarians are willing to listen, and so I have a great admiration for the Unitarian tradition. I also find it fascinating that when you come to Illinois in general, and to Springfield in particular, you're told that you're in the land of Lincoln. Have you ever thought about what an extraordinary compliment that is to the influence of that man? And Lincoln was born about 200 years ago, died about 150 years ago, and this area still calls itself the land of Lincoln. Do you suppose you'll ever see a day when New York State will call itself the land of Trump? That's an extraordinary compliment to a great human being, and I think it's also a compliment to this area for recognizing that you live in the heritage of this great person. So to my task. For the past 5 years, I have worked almost exclusively in my study life on the gospel that we call Matthew. The results of that study were published just about 6 weeks ago, February the 16th, by HarperCollins, under the title, Biblical Literalism, a Gentile Heresy. The subtitle lets you know that it has something to do with Matthew. The subtitle, which you'll only find on the inside title page, not on the cover, because Harper didn't like the subtitle, is A Journey into a New Christianity Through the Doorway of Matthew's Gospel. This book was an attempt to say that biblical literalism, biblical fundamentalism, is a basic Gentile misunderstanding of a Jewish sacred story. And that if we could just put Jewish eyes into our people, or at least give Jewish lenses to your glasses and have you read the Gospels through those new lenses, you would never possibly be a fundamentalist. Every book of the New Testament was written by a Jewish author. Every book. There's only debate about Luke, and Luke seems to have been born a Gentile and converted to Judaism, and then came from Judaism into Christianity, probably under the influence of Paul. But Luke is the only gospel writer that says it's really important that Jesus went through every one of the initiation rites of Jewish people. So Luke is the only one that has him circumcised on the 8th day, presented in the temple on the 40th day, and bar mitzvahed, except they didn't call it that in that day, when his parents took him up to Jerusalem when he was 12 years old. Those initiation rites were very important to this Gentile convert to Christianity. that all of the authors of the New Testament were Jewish. And they're trying to describe a Jewish life named Jesus of Nazareth in terms that their Jewish audience would understand. And Matthew is the most Jewish book in the entire New Testament. So if you look at Matthew's gospel and don't see references to the Hebrew scriptures, references to the Jewish synagogue worship, then you will not possibly understand what he's talking about. And if you do not understand what he's talking about, you will tend to literalize it and call it the Word of God. I find it fascinating that people refer to the Bible as the Word of God, as if somehow God dictated it. Folks, if you believe the Bible is the Word of God, you've never read it. There are some things in the Bible you don't want to blame God for. Some years ago, I was invited to give a talk at the Hemlock Society. It's not a place where religious leaders normally speak. But they thought it would be important to hear a religious perspective. So in preparation for that talk, I went through the Hebrew scriptures and I made notations about every sin or shortcoming for which you could be executed. None of us would be alive today if we took that literally. In the book of Deuteronomy, the Bible says that if you're a child and you're willfully disobedient and talk back to your parents, you are to be given to the elders of the city and stoned until dead at the gates of the city. Now please raise your hands, all of you who'd still be alive. The Bible also says if you have sex outside marriage, you are to be put to death. I will not ask you to raise your hand. But it also says that if you worship a false god, you should be put to death. Well, who's going to tell you who the true God is? Is it going to be the Ayatollah Khomeini? Is it going to be Pat Robertson? Is it going to be Benedict XVI? Is it going to be Ian Paisley? No matter who tells you who the true God is, somebody's at risk. And the most interesting one that I found in this study, and this is in Leviticus 20, you go home and check it out. It says that if you have sex with your mother-in-law, you shall be executed. How many of you knew that was in the Bible? How many of you have ever imagined it? And the reason you laugh is that you just tried to imagine it. One quick story to tell you how difficult it is to treat the Bible as the literal Word of God. In the congregation where I worship in Morristown, New Jersey, when we're in town, we have a lovely couple who moved to Morristown from Atlanta about 30 years ago with two precious little girls. One was about 6 months old, one was about 4 years old. These are spectacular girls. This was a spectacular family. They became leaders in the whole community and certainly leaders in our church. And we watched these little girls grow up. They were stars at every stage of their lives, in every activity, at school, in church, in choirs. And the oldest one went to the University of Vanderbilt University in Nashville, and prepared herself to be a school teacher, became a school teacher in the state of Washington, was quite athletic, did a lot of mountain climbing, and on one occasion she was climbing a mountain in the state of Washington and her ropes broke and she fell 465 feet to her immediate death. 4 years later, her little sister, now about the same age, also a graduate of Vanderbilt University, was visiting her boyfriend's family who lived in India, and they were swimming in the Indian Ocean and she was eaten by a crocodile. This family lost their only two children in weird, tragic accidents. I was sitting behind them at St. Peter's Church one Sunday morning, and the lesson was the story of Nathan the prophet confronting David and Bathsheba after their adulterous relationship had resulted in Bathsheba's pregnancy. And Nathan the prophet said, God is going to punish you for your adultery by killing your child. And then they finished the lesson and they said, this is the word of the Lord. And sitting behind that couple, I wanted to stand up and scream, "This is not the word of the Lord." But that would have been unseemly for the retired bishop to do. So I simply wrote a column about it. It's that kind of use of the Bible that causes the pain and the despair, literalizing these ancient texts which were never written to be literalized. I was raised in an evangelical Episcopal church in Charlotte, North Carolina, and that church taught me that segregation was the will of God and quoted the Bible to prove it. They taught me that men were created superior to women and quoted the Bible to prove it. They taught me that it was okay to hate other religions and especially the Jews, and they quoted the Bible to prove it. And they taught me that homosexuals are either mentally sick or morally depraved, and of course they quoted the Bible to prove it. When I think of the pain that has come in human history from an appeal to this ancient text, literally understood, it's been the source of anti-Semitism, the source of the Crusades against Muslims, the source of the justification of slavery, of segregation, of apartheid, of putting women down, and hating gay and lesbian people. That's not a heritage for which we should be proud. So does the Bible have any use? If it's been so negative, does it have any use? Well, I would suggest that if you could find a way to understand what it meant when it was originally written, you would find a powerful and provocative message that would speak to the deepest hunger in the human heart throughout the world today. So what I've tried to do in this book, Biblical Literalism and Gentile Heresy, is to peel back the levels of Gentile ignorance that has covered these sacred stories for most of their lives, and give people a glimpse of what the original Jewish authors writing to Jewish congregations really meant when they were writing these stories. Literalism was not on their minds, not even on their radar screen. Now, how do you do this? How do you do this in a, you know, it took me 360 pages in the book. How do you do it in one session with living people? You take a tiny little story out of Matthew's gospel and you illustrate it. So that's what I want to do with you this morning. And I want to take a story that everybody knows. It doesn't matter whether you're a Christian or an atheist, you don't live in this society without knowing this story, because it permeates the life of our culture. So focus for a few minutes on the story of Jesus' miraculous birth. First, some facts. The virgin birth of Jesus does not come in the Hebrew scriptures until the ninth decade. It is a very late development in the ongoing Christian tradition. Most people are surprised to learn that. It's introduced for the first time in Matthew's gospel, and Matthew's gospel was written sometime around 85, maybe as early as 82, but somewhere in that range. So the virgin birth story is never heard of until some 52 to 55 years after the crucifixion. And in the ancient world, 20 years was a generation. So you're talking about somewhere between the second and the third generation of Christian people. Only then does the virgin birth story come into the tradition. How do we know that? Well, we have other writers in the New Testament that wrote before Matthew. The first one is Paul. Paul is the first writer of anything that appears in the New Testament. Paul wrote all of his epistles between 51 and 64, 21 to 34 years after the crucifixion. That's as close as we can get. Does Paul say anything about the virgin birth? Not a word. Does he say anything that might lead you to believe he ever heard about the virgin birth? Not a word. Does he say anything about the origins of Jesus? Well, yes, he does. He says something about the origins of Jesus on two occasions. Writing to the Corinthians, he says of Jesus, quote, "He was born of a woman." That doesn't strike me as terribly unusual. The rest of that phrase is he was born of a woman born under the law. He was a human being born a Jew. That's what Paul is saying. And the word Paul uses for woman in that text is the Greek word gynaikos, from which we get our word gynecology, and it has absolutely no connotation of virgin within it. Paul says one other thing in Romans, the first four verses. He says that Jesus was descended according to the flesh from the house of David. In the ancient world, inheritance was only through the male line, because they didn't know that women were co-creators. They thought women were incubators, that all they did was to nurture the seed of life planted by the male. They didn't think women contributed to that life. So there's no way you can be descended from the house of David except through male ancestry. Paul had never heard of the virgin birth. So we move on. The first gospel to be written is Mark. Mark is dated by most scholars today around the year 72. That means he's 42 years after the crucifixion. Mark, the first gospel, is the product of at least the second generation of Christians. Does Mark say anything about Jesus having a miraculous birth? No. Open Mark and you discover that Jesus is a perfectly normal adult human being who comes to be baptized by John the Baptist. And only in the baptism do the heavens open and the Spirit of God descend, and he becomes a God-infused human life. God enters him at baptism, not at conception. There's one other place in Mark's gospel that makes that crystal clear, and that's the sixth chapter, where the mother of Jesus says that she thinks Jesus is, quote, beside himself, unquote. That's an interesting Jewish phrase, or Greek phrase. To stand outside yourself is to be schizophrenic, to be out of your mind, to be different from who you are. So the mother of Jesus is portrayed as thinking that Jesus is beside himself, and she gets his four brothers, and they're named in Mark's gospel, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas. Lots of people don't think Jesus had brothers, but that's a second century introduction to the Christian tradition. And so the mother of Jesus, and she's not called Mary, the mother of Jesus and these four brothers who are named go to take Jesus away. He's become an embarrassment to the family. He refuses to go with them. And he says, who is my mother? Who are my brothers? Those who hear the word of God are my mother and my sisters and my brothers. So it's quite obvious that someone who thinks the adult Jesus is out of his mind could hardly be identical with the person who had an angel tell her at the moment of her conception that she was going to be the virgin mother of the Son of God. It just doesn't work that way. Mark never heard of the virgin birth. So the virgin birth is introduced into the Christian tradition in the midst of the ninth decade, and obviously by Matthew. Now ask yourself, why in the world would Matthew do that? Why would he introduce this story? It's not a Jewish story. The Jews had traditions about miraculous or semi-miraculous births, but they weren't virgin births. The Jews had two categories of supernatural or special births. One would be postmenopausal pregnancies. Abraham and Sarah were in their 90s when she conceived. And it says in a delicate way in Genesis, it was past the time of women for Sarah. It's an interesting way to talk about menopause, isn't it? And she conceives, and she can't believe it. Well, most people couldn't believe it. But that's one of the ways that Jews said this is a very special life, because it had a very special birth. The other way was that they had women who were incapable of having children, and in that day they would always blame the woman for the failure to produce a child, never the man. They didn't know about low sperm count in those days. And that would be the story of Hannah when she had Samuel. It's also be the story of the unnamed mother of Samson. the man who was the strong hero. So they had two kinds of supernatural births if you were Jewish: postmenopausal pregnancy and pregnancy that overcame the inability to conceive. The idea of a virgin birth was a Mediterranean Greek idea. It was fairly popular. Alexander the Great was supposed to have been born of a virgin. Romulus and Remus were supposed to have been born of a virgin. So Matthew takes this very non-Jewish idea and incorporates it into his story at the very beginning. And typical of Matthew, he tries to ground it in the Hebrew scriptures. So he finds a text in the 7th chapter of Isaiah, which everybody here knows because they use it in all Christmas pageants. And if you know anything about it, you've either been a shepherd or a wise man or Mary and Joseph or maybe a donkey Christmas pageant in your life at some point. And so people are very familiar with that. And so at every Christmas pageant, you hear the quotation from Isaiah 7:14. And it reads, "Behold, a virgin will conceive and bring forth a child, and you shall call his name Emmanuel." Familiar story. The only trouble is that when Matthew quotes the Hebrew scriptures, he never quotes them in Hebrew. He always quotes them in Greek. If you go to the Hebrew text of Isaiah 7:14, the word virgin is not in it. The Hebrew word for virgin is betula. That is not there. The word that's used is alma, and that means simply a woman. And the tense of the verb is not the way Matthew quotes it either. It doesn't say, "Behold, a virgin will conceive." It says, "Behold, a woman is with child." Now, I submit those two things don't mean the same thing. Maybe things are different in Illinois, but where I come from, if a woman is with child, she is not a virgin. So Matthew misquotes the Isaiah text. Did he do it deliberately? I don't know. He quotes from a Greek translation of it. There's some wiggle room in some of the Greek words that are used. Or did he just not know? Or was he the kind of country preacher that pounced on a text when he thought it supported what he was trying to say, and he didn't bother to go into it in great detail? So the story is a fragile story built on a mistranslation of a text from Isaiah written somewhere in the 8th century before the Common Era. Now ask yourself why Matthew would suddenly decide to introduce this rather strange idea into his Jewish story. And the answer is clear if you read the rest of the New Testament. It was very obvious that by the time Matthew wrote this story, the critics of Jesus and the Jesus movement were attacking the movement with all kinds of innuendo about Jesus and his origins. And we know that because we have references to it in the New Testament. The first one is in that same place in Mark 6, when Jesus' mother and brothers go to take him away. But prior to that, he's preached a sermon in the synagogue at Nazareth, and it must have been a pretty impressive sermon because the crowd is asking questions like, "Where did this man get all this learning?" And some voice in the crowd said, "Is not this," speaking of Jesus, "is not this the carpenter?" Please note that it's not Joseph. He's never been introduced into any story yet. Jesus is the carpenter. "Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary?" Well, if you were Jewish, you would know that to call a grown man the son of a woman was to cast aspersions upon his paternity. It'd be a veiled way of saying, "Nobody knows who this kid's father is. He's probably illegitimate." That same theme is found in Matthew's story when he has Joseph wrestling with whether or not to put Mary, his wife, away. She's expecting, but he knows it's not his child. So this theme of illegitimacy is even in Matthew's gospel. And finally, that's resolved in Matthew's gospel by an angel speaking to Joseph and saying, "The child is holy. Take Mary to be your wife." When you get to Luke, you find in Mary's song that we call the Magnificat that Mary says that God has looked upon the low estate of his handmaiden. That may also be a reference to the fact that she was pregnant outside of wedlock, because there was no estate in Jewish society more desperate than be an expectant mother without a male protector. And then you get to John, where you find the same echo. In the 8th chapter of John, there's a crowd around Jesus, and they're discussing his origins. And it's not a pleasant crowd. And somebody in the crowd shouts to Jesus and says, "We were not born of fornication." Now, what's the implication of that? Jesus was. So these attacks were swirling around. And Matthew decides that he will rise to the defense of Jesus and portray him as holy. And he does it based on a fairly weak text in Isaiah 7:14. So then you look at the rest of Matthew's gospel and you watch how he introduces the story of the virgin birth. And it's fascinating. He introduces it with the 17 most boring verses in the Bible. Nobody ever reads them. You open Matthew's gospel and it says, "And Abraham begat Isaac, and Isaac begat Jacob, Jacob begat Judah, and David begat Solomon, and Solomon begat Rehoboam." And you go through all the generations and nobody reads it. We skip over. But when you skip those verses, you're skipping what Matthew chose to be the introduction to the virgin birth story. And those 17 verses include the key that tells you how Matthew understood the virgin birth. And what is that? Well, in those 17 verses, Matthew includes four ancestral mothers. That's rare. In a day when nobody knew that women had an egg cell, nobody put women into any genealogical chart, because women didn't count. They were receptacles, they were incubators, they were not co-creators of life. So no women got into a genealogical chart of someone's ancestry. But Matthew puts four in. That's phenomenal, that's unusual. That ought to raise some questions. And then you read their stories. And every one of them have stories in the Old Testament which you could read, and if you were Jewish, you would know. The first one of these women is a woman named Tamar. If you want to read her story, you can read it in Genesis chapter 38. She is the daughter-in-law of Judah, one of the sons of Jacob. She's married to Judah's oldest son. He died. He dies without children, without heirs. And the text is rather brutal. The text says God killed him. And in Jewish society, if a widow lost her husband, it was the duty of the brother of her husband to marry her. If he already had a wife, that didn't much matter, because you could have multiple wives in those days. And you married her to raise up, quote, children to your brother. So she's married to the next oldest son of Judah. His name is Onan. And Onan's not real happy about this, because somehow a sudden death of a perfectly young, healthy male looks like it might be witchcraft connected with the woman. So Onan is not real happy to take on this chore. And well, he shouldn't be, because God kills him too. And so she's now a widow twice. And there's only one more son in Judah's family, and he's only 5 years old. And he's not really interested in taking on his brother's widow. He'd rather eat a chocolate eclair. And so Judah refuses to give her his youngest son as her husband. And he has a talk with Tamar, and he decides that the only place for her is to go back to her father, live in her father's house in shame as damaged goods, because you have to have a male protector. And so that's what happens to Tamar. She puts on the clothing of a widow and returns in shame to her father's house. And years pass, says Genesis 38. And as those years pass, things happen as they always do. And Judah's wife dies, so he is now a widower. He seems to have vast lands and cattle, and so he has to, the word gets around that he has to go to a village a good distance away to look after some of his cattle, and Tamar hears that her father-in-law is coming, and she knows that he's got to go past the gates of her village to get to his destination. And so she plots a scheme. It's all in the Bible, but you don't usually hear it preached on or read about. She takes off the clothes of a widow and puts on the clothes of a prostitute and positions herself at the gate of the city to solicit business. And Judah and his entourage comes by. She's veiled. He sees this prostitute and he decides to take advantage of her services. And so he goes over and they negotiate a deal. And Judah agrees that he'll send a lamb from his flocks the next day in payment for her services. And she says, "How will I know you'll be true to your word?" And then she demands that he leave some symbols of his life that will be redeemed only when the lamb arrives. And they are his signet ring, the rope of the girdle that went about his waist, and his staff. So Judah agrees to leave these. They have their time together, and Judah goes on to see about his cattle. And nobody thinks about that story again until 3 or 4 months pass. And then the rumor is that Tamar is pregnant. And Judah is irate because that means she has brought dishonor on his family. She is an adulteress. And so he arranges for her to be executed by fire. And they light the fires and they bring Tamar out. And as she approaches the fire, she says, "You might be interested to know that I am pregnant by the man who owns this signet ring and this rope and this staff." And Judah recognizes them as his own. And he spares her life. He takes her into his harem. She becomes his wife, even though under the laws of that society, that was an incestuous relationship. And she bears twins. They're called Zerah and Perez. And it is through Perez that the line that produced Jesus of Nazareth travels. Matthew introduces the virgin birth story by telling us that the line that produced Jesus traveled through incest. That's a strange way to introduce a story, isn't it? And then you go to woman number 2. And her name is Rahab. And if you want to read her story, you can read it in Joshua chapters 2 and 6. Rahab was called Rahab the prostitute. She ran a house in the red light district of Jericho, into which Joshua's spies came. They were going to spy out the city, but first they spied out a prophet. And they got caught. And Rahab the prostitute protected the spies of Joshua from the authorities of Jericho. She hid them under some flax on top of her roof. And when the authorities gave up their search, Rahab exercised a deal. "Now that I have saved your lives, when the army of Israel conquers Jericho, you must promise to save me and the members of my family." And so that pact is agreed. And when Joshua's army comes into Jericho, all of Rahab's family are gathered together in the brothel, which is located inside the walls. And they have clear orders that everybody in the house is to be spared. And Rahab apparently marries one of Joshua's army. And so Matthew is saying the line that produced Jesus flowed through the incest of Tamar and the prostitution of Rahab. What a strange way to introduce the virgin birth. Then you move to ancestral mother number 3, and her name is Ruth. You can read her story in the book of Ruth, but please don't skip the 3rd chapter. The book of Ruth has got some interesting things in it. There's a song in the book of Ruth that is used frequently at weddings. The words are, "Entreat me not to leave thee, For whither thou goest, I will go. Thy people will be my people. Where you die, I will die. It's a very romantic song, and I listen to it in weddings. But obviously the couple doesn't understand that in the book of Ruth, that's what Ruth is singing, not to her lover, but to her mother-in-law. I suspect that if brides and grooms knew that it was sung to the mother-in-law, they would not be quite so eager to use it. But in any event, in this story, Ruth is a widow. Her mother, Naomi, is a widow. There are no male protectors. These two women are not a viable family in Jewish society. They move back to the homeland of the Jews. They've been living in Moab. And Ruth does her best to provide for both of them. She would go out into the fields of a man that she knew was her distant kinsperson. His name was Boaz. And she would do what they call gleaning. That is, after the reapers had done what they could do, she would pick up what spare grain she could find. She could gather enough to make one little wheat cake to keep Naomi and Ruth alive another day. And she came to the attention of Boaz, who owned this land. And he was very pleased that this Gentile woman, this Moabite girl, would be so devoted to the care of her Jewish mother-in-law. So he ordered that they leave a little more grain in the fields and that they provide her with water and that none of these men dare to molest her. And Naomi hears this and she's pleased, and so she plots a scheme. At the end of the harvest season, we have a great harvest ball, and all the people will be celebrating and the wine will be flowing greatly. Freely. And she says, Ruth, you must go to that celebration. So Ruth got her best dress, bathed in the river, used whatever perfume she had, and went to the party. And Naomi had said, be ready, for when Boaz is well drunk, that's the time to strike. So about midnight, after Boaz has had more wine than most people should have, he sits down and goes to sleep on the floor. And Ruth goes and gets a pillow and puts under his head and a blanket and puts over his body. And then she climbs under the blanket with him. And the next morning he wakes up and there's this woman under his blanket with him. And he says, who are you? And she says, marry me. She says, you are the nearest of kin. You have a responsibility under the Jewish law. And he said, oh, surely there must be somebody closer to kin than me. Than I guess that ought to be. And so he searches out and he finds somebody closer, and this person wants nothing to do with it, because not only do you get Ruth to be your wife, you get Naomi to be your mother-in-law. And so Boaz finally does the right thing. Ruth has seduced him. And they produce a child whose name is Obed. And the line that produced Jesus flowed through the incest of Tamar, the prostitution of Rahab, and the seduction of Ruth. What's Matthew say? And then he comes to the final woman. You can read her story in the 11th chapter of 2 Samuel. She's not even named in the genealogy. She's called the wife of Uriah. But we all know who the wife of Uriah is, if we know anything about the Bible. Her name is Bathsheba. Bathsheba means daughter of Sheba. She's from the kingdom where the queen of Sheba came to visit King Solomon. She's a foreigner. But Ruth was a Moabitess. And Rahab was a citizen of Jericho. And Tamar was a Canaanite. All of these ancestral women are non-Jews. And you read Bathsheba's story and you discover that David went out on the top of his roof one day in the cool of the evening, and because he was the king, he had the tallest house, so he could look down on the rooftops of everybody else in the town of Jerusalem. And beneath him, a block or so away, he saw this exquisitely beautiful woman taking a bath on what she thought was the privacy of her rooftop. And the king was smitten with her charms. And he sent a messenger inviting her to come and have a tryst with the king. Well, the Bathsheba had a choice in that matter is highly debated. When the king commands, the subjects respond. So she came, and they had a tryst. I suspect that was not the first nor the last that David ever had. So after she left, it was business as usual. He pretty much forgot about her. But 3 or 4 months later, he got a message for the king's eyes only. And he opened this message, and it was from Bathsheba, and she said, "Mr. King, you might be interested to know that I'm pregnant with your baby." And David says, "Well, are you not married? How do you know it's my baby?" And he said, "Oh yes, I'm married. My husband is Uriah the Hittite, but he's been in your army for over 6 months in the field of battle. No, Mr. King, there's no way this baby is anybody but yours." It was an interesting dilemma. The king said, "Okay, I'll give Uriah a furlough. He'll come home and he'll stay with his wife, and then the baby will come and we'll just say it came early." That'll be the first time that story has been used. So Uriah comes home on furlough. He has no earthly idea why he's being given a furlough. But what the king didn't count on is Uriah was the original Cub Scout. And he said, "Oh, it wouldn't be appropriate for me to enjoy the pleasures of my home and marriage bed while my buddies are fighting, bleeding, and dying in the foxholes out in the field of battle." And so he refused to go into his house. He set up a pup tent out in front of his house and slept there very ostentatiously. And David said, "Oh, what a turkey." So he had to come to plan B. Plan B was that they sent a message to Captain Joab by the hand of Uriah the Hittite to organize a flying wedge and to go at the gates of the city and to put Uriah at the point, which they do, and he's struck down and killed. And Joab sends a message to the king, "Your problem is now taken care of." The king sends for Bathsheba, and she joins his harem. The first baby dies, as I mentioned earlier. The second baby was named Solomon. Those are the four ancestral mothers. Every Jew would have known that background. Every Jew would have understood that. They knew those stories. And Matthew is saying that the line that produced Jesus of Nazareth flowed through the incest of Tamar, the prostitution of Rahab, the seduction of Ruth, and the adultery of Bathsheba. What is he saying? That's how he introduces the first version of the virgin birth to find its way into the Christian scriptures. Matthew is not talking about biology. He's talking about his witness to the holiness of Jesus' life. And what he is saying is, this child is holy, this child is born of God. But if you don't believe that, if you find my text too weak to support that argument, then it really doesn't matter, because God can raise up a holy life even through incest and prostitution and seduction and adultery. It's a rather remarkable story. God is able to transform any human weakness into holiness. That's how the virgin birth story enters the Christian tradition. And everybody who knew Jewish scripture would have known that he wasn't talking about biology. A couple of other things that make this even more obvious. Go back to the idea that a woman was simply a vessel, not a contributor to life. The eggshell wasn't discovered until the early years of the 18th century. I would suggest to you that the march of women into equality began with the discovery of the egg cell and the realization that every woman is an equal co-creator of every life that's ever been born. But the moment you understand that a woman has an egg cell, every virgin birth story dies. What the virgin birth story says is that since the woman is not a contributor but only an incubator, you never have to get rid of the human mother to have a divine life born. You've only got to get rid of the human father. So the human father is replaced by a divine figure, in this case by the Holy Spirit. But once you have an egg cell, there is no way a divine being plus a human mother will give you one who is fully human and fully divine. The best it will give you is one who is half human and half divine. You get a blend, you don't get one or the other. That's a rather interesting thing. So we've turned Jesus, if you literalize the virgin birth and make it biology, you've turned Jesus into something of a mermaid. He's half one thing and half another. One of those figures in Greek mythology that has a human head and an animal's body. That is not what the church was trying to communicate. What they were trying to communicate in the virgin birth story is that in and through the fullness of his humanity, the full meaning of God has been revealed and made clear. Virgin birth will not get you that. Half human, half divine is as close as that will come. And so the whole idea of a virgin birth finally kills the basic affirmation that the Christians have made about who Jesus is. There's one other detail that I think we need to bring into being here. The egg cell was discovered in the early part of the 18th century. This means that if Jesus has a human mother who passes on 50% of his genetic makeup, that mother is also the child of Adam, and she will pass on original sin. You can't escape it. And so the idea of Jesus as the sinless one gets compromised. It took the Christian church a while to work that one out. But by the 19th century, they had managed to do so. It's called the doctrine of the Immaculate Conception of the Blessed Virgin, which suggests that prior to Mary's birth, she was immaculately conceived, and so she could not be one who would pass on the original sin of Adam to the sinless Christ. So you have the development of a doctrine called the Immaculate Conception in the 19th century to counter the new knowledge about women having an egg cell. Theology does respond to reality from time to time. Following the Matthew story, no virgin birth in Paul, no virgin birth in Mark, virgin birth introduced in Matthew, a different version of the virgin birth introduced in Luke, and then you get to John and the virgin birth disappears. A lot of people don't understand that, don't even know that. The five major writers in the New Testament, Paul, Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John, only two of them suggest that the virgin birth is a part of the Jesus tradition. Three of them never mention it. Two of them seem never to have heard about it. John seems to have rejected it. Why do we say that? Because there's no virgin birth story in John, and he surely lived on the other side of both Luke and Matthew. He could not possibly have not known about that. But in chapter 1 and in chapter 6 of John's Gospel, you will discover that he refers to Jesus very simply as the son of Joseph. No mystery about that for John. No mystery. So how literal do you want to be about the virgin birth? Matthew didn't mean that to be read biologically. John certainly didn't take it seriously. He rejects it. Paul and Mark never heard of it. But after a while, the virgin birth became the primary doctrinal defense of the divinity of Jesus, which is very strange because probably the most profound and divine portraits of Jesus printed in the New Testament are in Paul and John. Paul appears never to have heard about the virgin birth. John appears to have rejected it. But we tied the divinity of Christ to this virgin birth story. And when the creeds of the church were adopted in the 4th century, the virgin birth was in the center of the creed. In fact, if you listen to the creed literally, the only thing Jesus really did was to get born and die. The creed goes immediately from the virgin birth to suffering under Pontius Pilate, as if his life had no other value. And throughout history, literalizing the virgin birth became the primary way we defended the doctrine of the Incarnation, and later the doctrine of the Holy Trinity. It's not quite the way literalists think. Now, can you make a case for the divine Christ apart from the virgin birth? I think that's easy to do. But you've got to be careful, and you've got to stop assuming that you understand who God is. Nobody can tell you who God is or what God is. Don't be fooled by that. That's hysterical when somebody says they can define God. All a human being can do is to define what they believe their experience with God is. And they might be quite delusional. If you've ever been to mental institutions, you know that there are an awful lot of people who think God communicates to them every day. Very real. I went to see one patient in St. Elizabeth's Hospital who every time I visit got a telephone call from God. She'd interrupt the visit and go get on the phone and talk to God. The only trouble is there wasn't a phone. But she was so convinced of that after a while I thought, I must be the problem, I can't see the phone. Fortunately, she was an elderly lady, and when she spoke on the phone, she spoke like this. Those of you who are under 40 don't know what in the world I'm talking about. And that gave me a sense that maybe I was still sane. So I can't tell you that my experience of God is objectively real. I might be delusional, but I don't believe so. And I'll let life test that. But when I experience God as life. And the God who is the source of life calls me to worship God by living fully. And the more fully I can live, the more I make God visible. And I experience God as the source of love, calling me to love, freeing me to love. And the more fully, the more wastefully I can give my love away, the more I believe I can make God visible. And thirdly, I believe I experience God as what Paul Tillich called the ground of all being. It's a cumbersome phrase. But if God is the ground of all being, the only way I can worship God is by having the courage to be everything that I am capable of being. And the more deeply and fully I can be all that I am, the more I make God visible. And the reason I'm a Christian is that when I look at Jesus of Nazareth, I see a life fully lived. I see a love totally given. I see one who is free to be who he is at every moment of his life, even when he's being put to death. And so I make the affirmation that I see the reality of God in the humanity of Jesus. But I also see the reality of God in the humanity of every other child of God when they live fully and love wastefully and dare to be all that they can be. And this is the mission of my Christian faith. It's not to make you religious. God knows we've got enough religious people in the world. And most of them are crazy. The purpose of the Christian faith is to call you into being whole. To call you into the fullness of life. To call you into the capacity to love, to give your life away in love. To call you to the courage to be all that you can be. And if we could ever get the Christian church to understand its own message and to live that message out, then there is a real future for Christianity. But for that literalized version that quotes the Bible to justify every prejudice under heaven, I don't think there is a legitimate future. And that's why beginning to read the Gospels with Jewish eyes makes all the difference in the world to the future of the Christian faith. Well, I hope that gives you enough to think about. Thank you for your attention. I've been in the business for a long time, so I have some rules about questions. Rule number one is that every other question has to come from a woman. church has listened to male voices only for far too long. And I want the first question. I want the first question to come from a woman, and I understand it's already been planted. Rule number two is try to make your questions questions. I'm amazed at how few people know how to ask a question. They make speeches and then ask a question. It's not just religious people, it's the Washington Press Corps. Everybody's trying to play gotcha. And the third is not a rule, but a request. Some of you know that I write a weekly column on the web. Anybody here receive the column? A few people. In that column, there's a column and then there's a question and answer feature, and I get my questions from real people. So if you would like to have your question, whatever it is, considered for publication in my column, if you're willing to do that, then I need for you to write it down on a piece of paper, and my publisher, a little company out in the state of Washington, requires that you give your name and hometown so that they'll be sure that I didn't sit in my study and dream up questions that I thought people ought to ask. So these are real, that's their way of authenticity. And if you don't want your, the column gets opened about 100,000 times a week and goes all over the world. So if you don't want your name on this column, tell them your name is John Smith. They're not going to check you out. But I'd love to have your question, and I can't answer them all. Only get one a week. But I try to take at least one question out of every venue that I have a chance of addressing. If anybody's interested in receiving a column, there's a place somewhere, I don't know where you can sign up, out in the back room, where you can sign up to receive it. Now, with that introduction, I'll take the first question, which I understand has been assigned.
Yes, sir, ma'am. It has.
This is a prepared woman.
Indeed. And I wrote my question down because of my age, my memory is... So, the Episcopal Church in 1974 had the Philadelphia 11 women who were ordained as priests, and in fact, their ordinations were ruled invalid. But by 1977, ordinations of women were accepted by the church, and the 11 ordained women and other women were finally recognized by the church. Now, in the Catholic Church, we have the Danube Seven. Seven women who in 2002 were ordained on the Danube River and afterward very, very publicly excommunicated. Since then, 215 more women have been ordained priests and bishops. The last three popes have said no to women's ordination, and Pope Benedict went so far as to equate the ordination of a woman as grave a sin as pedophilia. So what was it in the Episcopal Church, what was the catalyst that moved the needle so far in your church that the ordinations were accepted after only 2 years? What was the driving force that brought to the table to change mind?
We just have more aggressive women in the Episcopal Church. I don't want to be negative toward my Roman Catholic brothers and sisters, but one of the things that they have done is to identify, I lost the nickel, is to identify sacred tradition with human sin. It's not a sacred tradition of an all-male priesthood. It's the sin of discrimination against women. And we're all guilty of that. In this country, young women today don't recognize the struggle that women have had to go through to get to where we are. I find it fascinating that young women are not supporting Hillary Clinton over Bernie Sanders. I just find that interesting because it means they don't understand history. I don't mean to endorse either candidate. I think they're both good people. But it's a fascinating thing to watch women for whom Hillary Clinton is the symbol of breaking through the glass ceiling in politics, and they are supporting a 74-year-old Vermont man named Bernie Sanders. Women could not enter any major university in the United States until the 20th century. They didn't enter most of our major universities until after World War II. Women had no ability to enter the workforce. They got into the workforce by being secretaries to the lordly executives, by being nurses and aides to the lordly doctors, and by being teachers when all the men were principals. And it's been a struggle for women. But the struggle has been largely won. Whether you like Hillary Clinton or not, she's a symbol of the fact that a woman can run for president as an equal candidate today, and people can imagine a woman being the president of the United States. And England, which is not a very progressive country, had Margaret Thatcher long before we had Hillary Clinton. But they said of Margaret Thatcher, she's a man dressed up like a woman. They couldn't sort of embrace that. We've had to go through lots of struggles with that. But the women's movement, the feminist movement, is not very old. We can still remember the Gloria Steinems and the Bella Abzugs who fought and broke. When our women, the 11 you talked about, I had two of them in my diocese. They were wonderful priests, but they were not the kind of person I'd want to marry. Those women, in order to do what they did, had to be bold enough to break down every barrier that confronted them. And today, we ordain women, and they have no earthly idea the price that these women paid to let them walk through that door. And my church today, I'd say close to 50% of our clergy are female today. My rector is a woman. Her name is Janet Broderick. She's got a brother named Matthew Broderick that some of you might know. He shows up every now and then. The presiding bishop of my church until a year ago was a woman. The bishop of Nevada was elected to be the presiding bishop of my church, and she served her full term and retired about a year ago and was replaced by the bishop of North Carolina, who is our first African American. So there's been great progress to break down the barriers in this church. When I was growing up in Charlotte, if a black person had attended my Episcopal church, the police would have been called and they would have been arrested for trespassing if they only came to worship. We've come a long way. In the church I was raised in, a woman could do nothing except sing in the choir. She couldn't serve on any governing body. Today we've had a woman be our presiding bishop. Consciousness grows and changes. What you've got in the Roman Catholic tradition is centuries of the oppression of women by an all-male priesthood. And they try. They talk about women are not discriminated against, women are just different. That's what they say. And they do a lot to elevate women to prime positions, heads of colleges and various and sundry things. But I lived through the period where we thought segregation was separate but equal. It's always separate, it's never equal. And in the power lines in the Roman Church flows from the Pope to the Cardinals to the Archbishops to the Bishops to the Priests to the Deacons to the lay people. If you aren't in that power line, you are powerless. And so there will never be equality until that power line is broken. It will be broken. I'm not sure it'll be in my lifetime. I thought once it would be. Francis is an enormous step forward from Benedict. But the system still has got a long way to go. The thing that will drive women into ordination in the Roman Catholic Church, officially, not like you unofficially, but officially, will be that they have an enormous clergy shortage. And one of the ways you overcome a clergy shortage is you double the base of those who can be ordained. And if they would allow their clergy to be married, they wouldn't have a shortage anymore. And if they allowed women to be ordained, they wouldn't have a shortage. And eventually, they're going to need women to keep the institution alive. When John Paul II was the Pope, on one Ash Wednesday, about 2000, he issued a statement of apology for all the people that the Roman Catholic Church had hurt. He included among that people of color, because the Pope has owned slaves. He included among that women who had been discriminated against. And I was talking with James Carroll, who's a former Roman Catholic priest, the author of a book called Constantine's Sword. And he said, if you understand how Rome works, John Paul is laying the groundwork for the ordination of women, because you can't apologize to women and keep on treating them in the same way. Once you apologize, you've got to say, we've been wrong. And eventually they'll come around, but Rome moves in centuries, not in months or days or weeks. But I think that being aggressive helps. The big problem with being aggressive in the Roman Church is that there's no democracy anywhere. It's all an authoritarian situation, which is not all bad. You know, a dictatorship is the best form of government, provided you have a perfect dictator. The only problem with dictatorship is there's no such thing as a perfect dictator. But it's quite efficient, because if the Pope smiles, they smile all the way down the line. If the Pope says, we will ordain women, they will ordain women all the way. It doesn't take a lot of democracy. But I think you build up the pressure. The Roman Church is not healthy today. No institutional branch of the Christian Church is healthy. The Roman Church's statistics would be in as big a free fall as the mainline Protestants if they didn't have constant refugees coming in and feeding their statistics. You take the refugees away and their statistics are going straight down, and they know that. Clearly, Francis was an attempt to turn abruptly in a new direction. So we live, we work with them where we can, we challenge them where we can, and I think that's the best you can do. That situation doesn't lend itself to a democratic surge. But after a while, you know, to be practicing slavery in the 21st century becomes absurd. To be practicing discrimination against women in the 21st century also becomes absurd. And they'll get the message sooner or later, one way or another. Thank you. We'll now take a gentleman.
I'm Elijah Singley. And in her book, The Gnostic Gospels, Elaine Pagels has a chapter which is titled, God the Father, God the Mother. I'm curious to know, in your reading, if you think that there is any treatment of the Gnostic Gospels in the traditional Christian Gospel.
Well, Elaine Pagels is a very close friend of ours, and a great scholar, a Harvard PhD, and teaching today at Princeton. She was married to a world-class physicist named Hans Pagels, who was killed in a mountain climbing accident. I think her book is brilliant. I think it's the best book on the Gnostic Gospels. The Gnostic Gospels, they're mostly second century works. I don't find myself terribly drawn to them. They've magnified the miraculous almost to an absurd place. There's one story in one of the Gnostic Gospels where Jesus is making some mud birds, and he's doing it on the Sabbath. And he's accused by the religious authorities of violating the Sabbath by making the birds. But he waves his hand over and the birds become real and fly away, so there's no evidence to convict him. Now that's a nice story. But I don't know that that's of the essence of the Gospels. I'm going to talk about the Gospel of James a little bit in Peoria. At least I think that's what I'm going to talk about. But if you want to know about the Gnostic Gospels, that's the best source. But I don't find the Gnostic Gospels terribly informative to the original Christian story, because they're second and even third century works. And by that time, the Christian story has become very Grecianized, and it's lost its Hebrew roots. I would still, if you want to know anything about it, that's a good book, and it's a very brief book. It's less than 200 pages, as I recall. And she's a beautiful and lovely, lovely human being. Thank you for your question. A lady.
I'm Sandy Shepherd, and I am here with about, I would say, over 35 members, friends, spiritual leaders, and fellow students of Unity. That's Unity Church of Practical Christianity. And we want you to know that you are our brother, and we behold the Christ in you. And my question is this. How old were you, and what were you doing when you first began to understand your place in the grand scheme? And can you describe that time for us?
Yes, I can, but you don't want to hear it all. I wrote a book that I thought would be my last book, but I've now written six last books. While Here I Stand, My Struggle for Christianity of what were the three words?
Love, equality.
Love, equality, and integrity, or something like that, which is my autobiography. And it tells a story, but it's about 400 pages long. Let me put it in as brief a capsule as I can. For reasons I don't fully understand, God and church were very important to me when I was just a little kid. I can remember just loving going to Sunday school. And maybe that was because my Sunday school teacher, his name was Estelle Dara, I still remember, was simply such a loving person. I just loved to go there and be hugged by her. I don't remember anything she taught me. But I remember it was a warm and comfortable and loving place, and I loved going. She had a husband named Herbert Dara, and he taught me in the seventh grade, and it was on the Ten Commandments. And I was 12, and precocious, I'm sure. Because as he went through the Ten Commandments, he skipped commandment number 7. He went from murder to stealing. And I knew something was missing, so I raised my little hand and said, "Mr. Dara, you skipped adultery. What does adultery mean?" It was an innocent question. I had no earthly idea what adultery meant. And he got very flustered and said, "You'll learn about that when you get older." And that's all I remember from his class on the Ten Commandments. Which leads me to suggest that the primary purpose of Sunday school is not to give us information, but to give us an experience of love. And the information will come later. But I can remember as a little child going home and playing communion. I can't tell you what I used for wine, but I'm quite sure it wasn't alcoholic, because that was not allowed in Mecklenburg County in North Carolina unless you knew the local bootlegger, whose name was Carl Lifford, whom I happened to know. We had two famous people living on our street. One was Billy Graham and one was Carl Lippard, and we knew them both. And I was a thoroughgoing fundamentalist, and probably the reason for that was that it offered me security. That's why I want to be sympathetic to fundamentalists, because I think if you ask them to give up their fundamentalism, you're asking them to give up their personal security. And that makes them shake in their boots. And I was living in a fairly dysfunctional family. My father was an alcoholic. He died when I was 12. My mother did not finish the ninth grade of school and was functionally illiterate. And we lived in pretty abject poverty, and I was very convinced that I had a heavenly father who could do for me what my earthly father didn't do. So fundamentalism was my lifeline to survival. But then I got to be about 14, and I knew too much to make fundamentalism make sense anymore. Just learning what you learn in school when you're 14. There is no God above the sky who's going to do miracles. There is no original perfection from which we have fallen into original sin. Those things don't make a lot of sense. Jesus cannot ascend into the sky and get to heaven. If he ascends into the sky, he gets into orbit. Just those little things, it didn't make any sense. And at that time, World War II had ended, and we had a new priest that came to my church. His name was Robert Crandall. He was from Macon, Georgia. And he was different from any priest I'd ever known. He was 32. I thought you had to be at least 80 to be a priest. I'd never met one who wasn't 80. He drove a Ford convertible. I thought clergy drove hearses. He wore white buck shoes. I thought they wore lace-up Oxfords. And he had a gorgeous wife. And I thought all clergy wives were dowdy, dressed in brown or navy blue with a bun in the back of their head. It's the only kind of clergy wife I'd ever known. And this man, he and his wife Erin, had no children, and for reasons I do not know, they liked me. And they became my surrogate parents, and Bob became my surrogate father. And I was a church rat. I wanted to be everywhere Bob Crandall was. So I would go down to the 8 o'clock service which is the service for the Gnostic few in the Episcopal Church. And he was rather Catholic in his orientation, so he taught us that we had to receive communion fasting. You didn't want to mingle the body of Christ with a bit of undigested toast. And so I tried. So I would fast, and I carried the Charlotte Observer in those days, and I'd get up at 4:30 in the morning, deliver 150 papers, come home, shower, dress, get on the bus, go downtown to my church. I'd been up half a day by the time the 8 o'clock service, and I was really famished. And if you know anything about the Episcopal Church, we had in the middle of the communion service a long, tedious, two-page prayer called the Prayer for the Whole State of Christ Church. I never made it through that prayer. I either would turn green and throw up on the altar, or I would faint dead away and they'd have to come carry me out. I never got through the Eucharist. And I really did create quite a mess, I suppose. You know, my offering at the altar was not one that was generally accepted. That broom and mop squad would come in clean up for the acolyte. But despite that, this man still wanted me there. And after the service was over, he and I would go down to a little Greasy Spoon restaurant on the main street of Charlotte, and we would eat breakfast together, and he would talk with me. And he talked with me. He didn't talk to me. He didn't talk at me. And he would listen to my ill-formed, immature opinions, and he wouldn't criticize them. And this man gave me life that I'd never had before, and I never wanted to be anything else in my life except just like Bob Crandall. Now, to show you how life goes, Bob was forced out of the ministry for being an alcoholic, which developed about 10 years later. So most of my father figures turned out to not be very healthy. But that's the story, and I began to work through my prejudices. The civil rights movement brought me into a whole new understanding that black is beautiful and black is human. And what we were doing to black people was incredibly evil. I don't know that I was terribly heroic. I told the people who were interviewing me earlier that when Dr. King marched from Selma, I was maybe 26 years old, and I wasn't heroic enough to be there. But I wanted to identify with him, so I chose as the opening hymn for my church, a little church in Eastern North Carolina, the hymn, "Lead On, O King Eternal," and I thought that was so clever. Not a soul got it. Not a soul. So my protest went off into the blue somewhere. But it was about 2 years later that the Supreme Court ordered the desegregation of the schools in our county. And that's when the fat hit the fire. And I'm happy to tell you that one of the proudest moments of my life is when I was named public enemy number one of the Ku Klux Klan in Edgecombe County, North Carolina. I got my mind straight about that, and I had to deal with women. And God, in her graciousness, bestowed upon me and my wife three wonderful daughters. And they weren't just ordinary daughters. They were aggressive feminist daughters. One of them today is a senior vice president in Wells Fargo. One is the chief staff attorney to the Virginia Supreme Court. And one has a PhD in physics from Stanford and is in the high-tech business in California. And it was hard for me to tolerate my daughters being treated unequally because they were women. I didn't want anybody to tell me my daughters couldn't be either the president or the pope because they were born female. And that became a burning passion, so I became part of the feminist movement. And I had the first female archdeacon in the Anglican Communion in my diocese, and we worked really hard to promote women. And I was homophobic. I mean really homophobic. It wasn't even on my radar screen. I didn't know much about homosexuality. I just thought it was bad. And I didn't know any homosexual people. At least I didn't think I knew them. Four members of my 12 male vestry were unmarried men in Richmond. It never occurred to me to think one of them might be gay. And I don't mean to suggest that if you're unmarried, you are gay. I do mean to suggest that if four men on one vestry are single, that the possibility that none of them is gay is minimally small. And they were all socially acceptable people. They served a function in Richmond. They were, one was a member of the Supreme Court, one was an attorney for the local newspaper. They were very successful people. And they escorted socially acceptable widows and socially acceptable divorcees to socially acceptable Richmond parties. And I noticed that they never escorted the same lady. They just sort of floated around, and whoever was available escorted. And people said of them, well, they're not the marrying kind. It just never occurred to me to think they might be gay. That wasn't on my radar screen. I moved to New Jersey when I was elected bishop in 1976. And for the first time, I met gay and lesbian people who were not ashamed to be gay and lesbian, who were fully self-accepting. You know, I thought they at least ought to try to hide it. And I began to have to deal with these people, and I had several episodes where it was clear I didn't know what I was talking about. And so I did what left-brain people like me always do. I called up a doctor at the Cornell School of Medicine in New York City. His name was Robert Lajita. And I said, Bob, I'm dealing with a gay population I've never had to deal with before, and I clearly don't understand anything about sexual orientation. You suppose the doctors at Cornell would be willing to educate a bishop? Well, they've never had a bishop before that wanted to be educated. And they thought that was kind of fun. So I worked with these doctors for about 6 months, and they convinced me that homosexuality is not a choice. It's an awakening. And that made sense. I didn't choose to be heterosexual. I just woke up when I was 12, and girls didn't seem obnoxious any longer. I didn't make a choice in the matter, but I started doing strange things like taking baths more frequently, using deodorant. I'd never done anything like that before in my life. Combing my hair. I did anything to get female attention, but I didn't make a choice. And if I could, somebody said, oh, you are now heterosexual, I wouldn't have understood what they were talking about because I didn't know what that word meant. I didn't know what the word homosexual meant. So it made sense to me that you don't choose it. And if you don't choose it, then you can hardly be condemned for being it. I didn't choose to be white. I didn't choose to be right-handed. I didn't choose to have green eyes or blue eyes or whatever they are. I didn't choose to be tall. Those are part of my persona. Those are givens. And I didn't choose my sexuality either. So you cannot discriminate against somebody because of what they are. Now people say to me, well, do you think all homosexual behavior is good? Of course not. But haven't you noticed that maybe all heterosexual behavior isn't good? And who are the pimps of the world? Who are the prostitutes of the world? Who are the child abusers of the world? They're overwhelmingly heterosexual people. You can judge behavior, you can't judge being. And as soon as you cross that boundary, your prejudices have to die. And so when I got my head straight about homosexuality, I had to help my church, and I did. The Episcopal Church today has openly gay bishops. When I retired, I had 35 out-of-the-closet gay and lesbian clergy serving. Everybody knew they were gay and lesbian. 31 of them had partners that were recognized in the community as their partners. They didn't talk about marriage in those days. I rejoiced when the Supreme Court set aside or made it possible for all people to receive the gifts of holy matrimony legally. And I think that's part of what the Christian faith cannot denigrate any child of God on religious basis, on sexual basis, on gender basis, on skin basis. And so the whole thing, and once you begin to get clear about that, then you read the Bible in a very different way. If there's anything in the Bible, in the New Testament, about Jesus, it is that in Jesus human divisions cease. In Christ there is neither Jew nor Greek, male nor female, bond or free, gay or straight, Sunni or Shia, Protestant or Catholic. And maybe the greatest division of all, in Christ there's neither Republican nor Democrat. The whole biblical story is that in Christ we come to a humanity that does not mean we have to build ourselves up by pushing someone else down. So prejudice is at the heart of what the Christian gospel is all about. and getting over it is our mission. Now that's 400 pages and far too long to answer your question. But it's a journey, and it's never ending. I don't have the answers, but I love the journey. I think it's a gentleman's turn.
Thank you for your work, your writings, your life. I think you mentioned in that autobiography that you spent special time with the writings of C.G. Jung, Carl Jung. And I was just wondering, is there anything that comes to your mind after your reading him that is what you consider his major contributions that we can benefit from now?
Well, that's a great big question, because he wrote a lot of stuff. And I think the book of his that was the most profound book I ever read is entitled Answer to Job. It's also one of the most difficult books I ever read. And I tried to distill it in one chapter of one of my books. And today people tell me that's the most profound chapter I've ever read, and others tell me I don't understand a thing you're talking about. So to be able to respond to you in a question-answer format. When I was writing my book on why I believe in life after death, which is called Eternal Life, A New Vision, I quoted Jung a lot, particularly in his concept of a collective unconscious to which we are sort of related and which is not finite like we are. That is, the collective unconscious has been there long before we arrive and be there long after we arrive, and yet we contribute to it and we learn from it, which seems to me to link us to something that's beyond mortality. I think there's still some other things that help me to understand the possibility of life after death. One is the gift of human intuition, which I don't think we quite understand. The other is those experiences that are far too numerous to be denied, and yet nobody can quite explain them, when people will wake up in the middle of the night thinking about somebody they love, and the next morning they get a telephone call that they had a heart attack or they had an automobile accident at that moment when they woke up, and you wonder how that connection went about. I don't understand it, but I think we're more connected than we think we are. The whole experience of prayer we have treated historically as sort of, I pray to the great IBM machine in the sky, and the IBM machine sends the message to you. And I think what we're beginning to learn is that when we pray for another, we lose positive energy, and it doesn't have to go through the IBM machine in the sky. It's just part of the transaction, and that we're connected. We're all sorts of studies that show that people that are loved don't get sick as often, get well quicker than people that aren't loved. So there's some power in love that we don't quite understand. I think it's fascinating that human beings are the only animal that can be hypnotized. And then somebody, without touching us, can control our activities, which indicates there's some sort of link. And I look at the evolutionary process, and it's so fascinating to me. It's almost a mystical experience to read Darwin. We started as nothing but physical matter. This universe appears to be about 13.8 billion years old. And there was nothing in it but physical matter. We can name the components. And that's true for about 10 billion years. And then out of physical matter came life. Single cell life. Nobody quite knows how. Then out of life developed primitive forms of consciousness. No more than an antenna relating to an environment at the beginning. But later, higher and higher levels. How conscious is a clam? We put clams into boiling water, alive. If they were conscious, I don't think we'd do that. We don't do that to our cats or our dogs, because we recognize a consciousness kinship. But even the most wonderful of our pets never quite participates in self-consciousness. Oh, I don't mean they don't have some sense of themselves as a creature. But only human beings can transcend the limits of our time and space. Only human beings write history about a time when we didn't live Only human beings envision a time when we are not alive. We live beyond the boundaries of time in a way creatures, no other creature does. And evolution isn't over. So what's the next step? From matter to life to consciousness to self-consciousness, I think the next step, and maybe this is what Jesus represented, is a step into universal consciousness, where we recognize the oneness of all things. DNA has pushed us. DNA we've only known about since the 1960s. But we now know that we are kin not just to the great apes, we're kin to the cabbages. We're kin to the plankton of the sea. All life is one unfolding experience, and we're DNA connected with every living thing. And that's part of the mystery of life. So I don't think that anybody who denies life after death knows enough to make that case. I also don't think that I know enough to make the opposite case, but I know enough to prove it as a mystery, and Carl Jung is a very important piece of leading me in that direction. I'm sorry I took so long to answer. Yes, ma'am.
Speaking of life after death, a couple of weeks ago, the Christian Church celebrated the resurrection of Jesus on Easter Sunday. And I would like to know if you would speak to that and how you understand the resurrection. It's been described as a metaphor, the absolute truth, and everything in between. I'd be interested in your views.
That's a good question, but all of your questions demand a book. And I've written them. I've got a book called Resurrection, Myth or Reality. And when I sent it to the publisher, it was called Resurrection, Myth and Reality, because I think it is. I think it's a reality that cannot be talked about except in mythological terms. But my publisher, HarperCollins, always likes to project me as very controversial because they think it's good for sales. And so they changed my N, A-N-D, to O-R, so it could look like I think the resurrection is either a myth or a reality, and you can debate the two. I think that's a misunderstanding. But let me go to what the Bible says. It's always a good place to start. Most people homogenize the Easter stories, and you come out with one continuous story. That's not the way it is in the Bible. The story grows. In Mark, the first gospel written, the person who announces the resurrection is a young man dressed in a white robe. It's not an angel. He's a young man dressed in a white robe. I've dressed in a white robe on many an occasion and nobody mistook me for an angel. When you get to Matthew, that young man in the white robe has become a supernatural angel who travels on the wings of the wind and who's lustrous and bright, whiter than any Clorox on earth could have gotten him, and doing miraculous things. When you get to Luke, it's two angels. The angels keep growing. When you get to John, it's two angels at first, and one of them seems to morph in front of your eyes into being Jesus. So where's the reality? That's over a period of 40 years that you can see those little changes. Are you aware there's not a detail of the resurrection that is not contradicted in some other part of the Bible? They don't harmonize. Who went to the tomb at dawn on the first day of the week? Paul doesn't know about anybody going. But all the Gospels have a different list. When you get to John, it's only Magdalene all by herself. She's the only one that's consistent at the tomb. Did the women see the risen Christ at the tomb at dawn on the first day of the week? No, says Mark. Yes, says Matthew. No, says Luke. Yes, says John. You can't put that together. Even Jerry Falwell can't balance that out. Who was the first one to see the risen Christ? Paul says it was Peter. Mark never tells you about anybody seeing him. No resurrection story in the first gospel. Matthew says it was the women. Luke says it was a man named Cleopas who we'd never heard of before. John says it was Magdalene all by herself. They don't agree on that. Where were the disciples when whatever the resurrection was dawned on their consciousness? Mark says it will be in Galilee. Matthew says it was in Galilee. Luke says it was never in Galilee. And John says it was in Galilee, but only a lot later. You can't put the details together. So does that mean they're false? No. It means that there's something about the resurrection that you cannot put into rational categories. And what is it? It is that Jesus was a boundary breaker. Jesus breaks every boundary that binds our humanity into anything less than it is capable of being. And the last boundary that he is portrayed as breaking is the boundary of death. I believe that this resurrection story began with acclamations. The grave cannot contain him. Death cannot contain him. We have seen the Lord. And after a while, the grave cannot contain him. It was spelled out in stories about an empty tomb, and we have seen the Lord was spelled out in stories about various visions. But they're all highly subjective. I'm convinced that there is a reality to the resurrection, but I can't tell you what it is. I think it had powerful effects. I think you can study the effects. Effect number one is the disciples, when Jesus was arrested, we're told, all forsook him and fled. But something brought them back, and something gave them courage that caused them never to deny the reality of whatever that vision was. So that's an effect that you have to look at. The understanding of God changed after the resurrection. All of them were Jews. They had been taught that God only was holy. You could only worship one God. And yet something happened at Easter that made it impossible for them not to see Jesus as part of who God is and God as part of who Jesus is. You can debate that all you want, but that's the experience. The very nature of God was changed for these people. And finally, within one generation, a new holy day was born. We Christians don't observe the Sabbath. That's the day of rest. That's Saturday. We observe Sunday, the day of the resurrection, the day God acted. And for a new holy day to be born, and within one generation to equal the Sabbath, and together create the weekend for our modern world, that's what we do. Jewish Sabbath, Christian Sunday forms our weekend. That's a rather enormous change to happen without something explaining it. People in church don't change very easily. I've said to my congregations, if the Lord God Almighty stood in some of my churches and said, I want you to start worshiping at 10:30 instead of 10 o'clock, somebody would stand up and say, but we don't do it that way here, Lord. And yet this new holy day is born. And it rivals the Sabbath within a generation, and it finally replaces the Sabbath as Christianity becomes more and more a Gentile movement. So there's a lot of reason to think that something of great significance happened. It's not easy to tell anybody what it is. And I think the more you try to literalize it, the less sense it makes. Now, that's probably a 280-page book. But it's a good question. I really appreciate it. And I really wrestle with the things you're asking about because I asked those same questions and I had to find answers for myself. And so I keep writing books. As I say, I've got 7 last books that I've already written, and I just signed a contract last week for one more last book. Yes, sir.
Thank you for being here. I'm a retired Unitarian Universalist minister, Reverend John Beidler from Decatur, Illinois. What do you ascribe the rise of literalism and biblical fundamentalism? Because it doesn't seem in the Middle Ages it was held to be literal then. How has it come to be so widely held as a book to be literally interpreted?
Well, I think first, there are two reasons, I think. And the first one is that by 150 of this common era, there was hardly a Jew left in the Christian movement. And so they didn't know how to read these Jewish stories. And the only way they knew how to read them was to literalize them. And they falsified them in the process. For example, is John the Baptist a real character? Oh, I think there's absolutely no doubt that a man named John the Baptist lived. And that he was an itinerant preacher in the first century before Jesus. I suspect that Jesus actually started as part of the John the Baptist movement. But the John the Baptist you meet in the Bible is not a figure of history. He's a Jewish figure called Elijah, being put into John the Baptist's mode. So the first thing that you read in Mark is that he introduces John the Baptist, And he says he was clothed with camel's hair and a leather girdle about his waist. Every Jew would have known that was the clothing attributed to Elijah. He said he lived in the wilderness. Every Jew would know that the wilderness was where Elijah lived. He said that he ate the diet of the wilderness, locusts and wild honey. Everybody would know that was Elijah's diet if they knew the Hebrew scriptures. And if you know the Hebrew messianic tradition, you would know that after a while, after Messiah became a concept, and that didn't happen until after the Davidic line was destroyed in the Babylonian exile, that's when the idea of the king of the Jews enters mythology and becomes a messianic figure. And they begin to build traditions about what's going to happen when the Messiah comes. And one of their traditions is that someone has to prepare the way for the Messiah's coming. And at first it's just a voice. The voice of him crying in the wilderness, that's in Isaiah. Prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. This was the forerunner. By the time you get to Malachi, the forerunner has been identified with Elijah. By the time you get to the Gospels, John the Baptist has become Elijah with his clothing, his diet, and his location. And every Jew would recognize that. They would not have literalized that story. They would know that Jesus never preached the Sermon on the Mount. But that's a new Moses story being told about Jesus. The Sermon on the Mount's based on Psalm 119. Gentiles wouldn't know that. Psalm 119 is the longest psalm in the Psalter. Why? Because they celebrated the giving of the law to Moses on Mount Sinai with a 24-hour liturgy, and they had to have a psalm long enough to last through 24 hours. That's why you got such a long psalm. And Matthew builds the Sermon on the Mount based upon that psalm, used for the Jewish day called Shavuot. And so we know that Jesus didn't preach the Sermon on the Mount. That's Matthew's attempt to portray him as the new Moses, giving a new interpretation of the law on a new mountain so that people would recognize the messianic image of the new Moses. And I could take you through. Jesus didn't go on top of a mountain and get lustrous and white and talk with Elijah and Moses. In the story we call the Transfiguration, it's not literal history. Moses had been dead 1,200 years. Elijah had been dead 800 years. Neither of them got illuminated. But if you know the Jewish calendar, you would know that that story was told at the time the Jews were celebrating the feast called Dedication, that you and I now call Hanukkah. We're celebrating the light of God being restored to the temple. But the temple had been destroyed by the Romans in the year 70. So Jesus is being portrayed as the new temple. So the light of God doesn't go on the temple, it goes on Jesus. And the symbols of the Jewish life, the law and the prophets, are subsumed under him. This is a Christian story. It's not literal. Did Jesus get crucified at the Passover? Or did they use the Passover to interpret the death of Jesus? Well, I think it's clearly the second and not the former. And that would really upset all those grocery stores that advertise Passover diet with Lenten diet. They won't be able to do that if they know history. But they'll probably do it anyway because their customers don't know history. But we've turned the Passover into the very setting of the crucifixion. A lot of biblical evidence of the crucifixion took place in the fall. Not in the early spring, but I haven't got time to go into that. I do that in the book, but don't have time to go into it now. So that what we've got to do is to learn how to read the Gospels without having that Gentile literalness imposed upon them. The second point, and I'll make this one quickly, I've just listened to 48 lectures on the history of Western art by a man named Klaus, who is the curator of the museum, the Smithsonian Institution in Washington. When you look at Western art, you remember that through most of the ages, very few people could read or write. So they couldn't read the Bible. They had to have it pictorially displayed to them. And almost all the art in the Western world was very religious until about 1600. And so they literalized the artistic works that they saw and assumed that they were accurate biblically. Best example of that is the story of Mary cradling the deceased body of her son at the foot of the cross. The Pietà. That's not biblical. Mary doesn't get to the cross in any gospel until the last one, about 95 to 100. And she's only there so that Jesus can address her and the beloved disciple. And if you know anything about John's gospel, you know that Mary is a symbol of Judaism and the beloved disciple is a symbol of the ideal Christian. And that's why that conversation is there. It's not because Mary ever went to the cross. She's not there in Paul, she's not there in Mark, she's not there in Matthew, she's not there in Luke, and that would really upset Mel Gibson. But we learned our fundamentalism because we could not read, and so we took these pictures painted as if they were literal episodes, and some of them are very, very graphic. In many of the museums, you'll see pictures of Jesus and John the Baptist as little children playing with the Virgin Mary. That's not biblical. The only place that hints that there was a relationship between Jesus and Mary and John the Baptist is in Luke, who has Mary go into the hill country of Judah to visit her kinsperson, Elizabeth. And while they are there, and this is when you know it's not history, they were there, the fetus, the baby, John the Baptist, in the womb of Elizabeth, leaps to salute Jesus in the womb of the Virgin Mary. They're both Jewish mothers. And one Jewish mother says, "Your baby's going to be greater than mine." No Jewish mother would ever say that. That can't be literal. So then you ask, what are we reading? And unfortunately, the Christian church has not allowed people to study the scriptures in such a way to find the profundity beyond the imposed literalism that we've put on them over the ages. And I could go on that because that's the theme of the whole book. Episode after episode after episode, I illustrate the antecedents, the Hebrew scriptures or liturgical antecedents against which the Jesus stories are told. I hope that... Thank you for your question. A lady.
Of the human persuasion, and in your biography, it says that one of the greatest fears we have as humans is death. And I am afraid to die. My sisters are not, because they believe they're going to be raised physically.
Yeah.
And when I am afraid in the middle of the night, I start praying, but I don't know to whom.
Yeah.
And I don't hear an answer.
Yep.
Got one?
Let me try. I remember as a child, I wasn't particularly afraid of death until my mother taught me to pray, "Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take." I hadn't thought about dying before I wake. So I think we build fear in. The second thing is that only human beings know they're going to die. That's what makes us human. That's why we're chronically anxious people. Now, animals often die. They don't buy life insurance. They don't write out a last will and testament. They just go off and die. But human beings, from the moment that death crosses your life and you know it's real, it's factored into everything we do. And we spend a lot of anxiety about it. I'm only anxious that Chris might die before I do. Christine is so competent she could run the UN and she wouldn't miss me at all. But I am so dependent on her, I'd be an absolute basket case, so I don't think I could survive. So we have a pact in our marriage that I have to die first. And like all godly women, she's supposed to be obedient to my will. I don't think you're going to get over that. And you see, I think when Christianity suggests it's got a cure for that, we're delusional. I don't believe that Christianity makes you secure. I'd like for us to get out from under the idea that Christianity gives you peace of mind. I think Christianity gives you the ability to cope with insecurity and the ability to live without peace of mind. And if you achieve peace of mind, I think you've got an idol. And I think you ought to try to get rid of that idol. Life is supposed to be anxious. That's the nature of our humanity. That's the gift of self-consciousness. And that's why only human beings take tranquilizers. That's why human beings are all drug addicts. You're all drug addicts. And you don't like that. But how many of you start the day every day with caffeine? Raise your hands. See, we're all drug addicts. We can't start the day without a drug. And how many of you use alcohol to calm down? You don't need to raise your hand. And smoking. What is smoking? Have you ever thought about that? Smoking is adult nursing. That's all it is. Cigarettes about the size of mother's nipple. Smoke's about the temperature of mother's milk. You smoke more when you're anxious. And it's socially unacceptable for a 45-year-old man to go around nursing. So he smokes instead. There's no other reason why a drug called nicotine that does nobody any good would be so universally practiced until we finally began to say, by the way, it kills you. And so the amount of smoking has gone down. So we just export all our cigarettes to China and Africa, and they continue to smoke like stove pipes over there. But anyway, we're always looking for some way to overcome our anxiety. I suggest you embrace it and walk with it as your friend and transform it only by living with it and accepting it. God does not call you to have peace of mind. God calls you to live life vigorously in the absence of peace of mind. And that's a very different way to live. Well, I've loved being with you, but I was told that was the last question, so I will be obedient and stop. Thank you for coming. Thank you for giving me this.